Well, good evening, brothers and sisters in the EPC. It is wonderful to be with you tonight for another episode of Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families. I am joined, as always, by my wonderful friend, Roy Yanke. Roy, say hello to the people.
Hello, people. It's always good to be here with Annie and just a wonderful time together.
Yes. So Roy is the executive director of PIR Ministries. And this webinar series is a partnership between PIR and the EPC. We want to work together to see our pastors and people married to our pastors growing and thriving as followers of Jesus, as whole persons. And so tonight we are delighted to be joined by Fred Lian and Beth Filston. I'll say a few words of introduction about both of them, and then I'll invite them to give us a little bit of a perspective on why they are happy to be with us tonight. Fred Lian is a retired EPC pastor. He also has background as a marriage and family therapist. And we are also blessed by Fred's leadership over the Ministerial Vocation Committee of the General Assembly. So you may know Fred from the famous face-to-face portion of our General Assembly gatherings where prospective pastors and search committees are able to connect with one another. So we're grateful to have Fred with us tonight. We're also joined by Beth Filston. Beth lives in Thomasville, Georgia. She is a licensed associate professional counselor. And as I was looking over her bio online, Beth has experience with just a huge variety of types of treatments for the people that she sees. So we're looking forward to having her contribution tonight as well. Beth is married to Pastor Tim Filston, who is the senior pastor of First Presbyterian Church in Thomasville, Georgia. So Fred, Beth, thank you both so much for joining us tonight. We're going to talk about the topic of healthy relationships. And before we dive in with some questions for the two of you, I'd love to hear what motivated you to want to be a part of this series. Why are you motivated to talk about healthy relationships?
Okay, I'll jump in. And thanks for inviting me and on behalf of Beth to be a part of this. So I want to give three caveats first before I answer your question. They'll be really brief. First, any insights that I have, it's as speaking as one imperfect pastor to other imperfect pastors. And I confess I haven't always been able to live out effectively the principles, the insights that I'll be sharing. It's an intentional choice, and I have failed on many occasions. Secondly, the insights that I share, I know aren't going to be new to any pastor, and I, at least intellectually, but I also know that it's the head knowledge that isn't deficient. It's oftentimes the discipline and desire to act upon those things that we know are right and best for our relationships. And then the third thing is, I consider orthodox theology, Christ-centered, biblically sound doctrine to be absolutely critical and essential for healthy relationships. So I don't want anyone to think that I'm putting my counselor hat over my theological hat. The scriptures have the primary force in my life and in this presentation. So with that said, the reason that this is so critical to me is because over the decades that I've been with the EPC since its founding, and over the decades, I have counseled many pastors who have gone through really hard times emotionally, relationally, personally, and with some of those situations, there have been moral failings. And what I have discovered is that in almost every situation where there was a moral failure, it was because there were not healthy relationships in the pastor's life. They had isolated themselves, and that opened them up to temptation. And it also caused real hardship for not only the family, but the church family as well. So this is really a major concern for me personally, and hopefully there'll be some benefit from this.
Thank you, Fred. Yeah. How about for you, Beth?
Yeah, thank you, Annie and Roy, for having us on here. And I agree with you, Fred. I think, of course, the counselor hat does not trump the biblical theology and principles that we live our lives by. So I think they go hand in hand, and that we are, I think Christians are the first ones to care about relationships. Like we prioritize those within that framework. The reason I'm so excited to be here tonight is because I care deeply about ministerial families. Having been a pastor's, well, I am a pastor's wife, but for 28 years, I just did not know what journey we were going to be on. And it came with lots of highs and lows, as life does bring us. But I care deeply because I want to be a resource and also minister to those who are in the ministry. And having had that perspective, it really means a lot to me.
Mm-hmm. Well said. Well, Beth and Fred, we kind of chose a provocative title for tonight's webinar: Healthy Relationships Are As Important as Good Theology. Why do you think it's important for us to make that sort of assertion when we are talking with pastors and people married to pastors?
Beth, take it away.
All right, that's a good question. I think that's, and you asked why is it a provocative title?
Yeah, and why do we need to affirm that when we're talking with clergy and people who are married to clergy, that healthy relationships are as important as their good theology?
Mm-hmm. Well, we're formed out of a relationship to be with, you know, the Trinity, to be with God, to be with the Holy Spirit. We're connected. And there, you can have both. I think some people want one or the other. But yeah, you can certainly have both. And we value relationships, and our health and relational health is where our ministry flows out of. Like that's where it comes from. So if we're not healthy in our relationships, then we cannot minister to others. And I think a lot of people do want one or the other, but they are both very important.
Yeah. And I'm going to reference a book here that has really given me some insight regarding this whole topic that we're talking about. It's a book called The Good Life: Lessons from the World's Longest Scientific Study of Happiness. And it was written by Robert Waldinger and Mark Schultz. And in the book, they asked this question: you had to make one life choice right now to set yourself on the path to future health and happiness, what would it be? Now, we'll simply assume that the number one choice needs to be faith and trust in Jesus. I mean, we'll do that as our foundation work right there. But the Harvard study of development has been studying this question: what keeps us healthy and happy as we go through life, since 1938. Mm. That's how long the study's been going on. And the Good Life book reveals the main conclusion from the Harvard study is this, and I quote: contrary to what many people think, it's not career achievement or exercise or a healthy diet. Don't get us wrong, those things matter a lot. But one thing continually demonstrates its broad and enduring importance: good relationships. And today, I received an email from a pastor friend who is investing himself in a new church ministry. He's got about 20 years worth of experience already. And he expressed all this excitement about this opportunity and how he believes that it's already challenging him to grow spiritually and in person. And yet, in the same email, at the very end, and it was a pretty long email, he asked for prayer for healing in his relationship with his wife, from whom he has been experiencing varying degrees of alienation during the time he has been pastoring. And I read that, and I'm just sitting back going, what's going on here? Where is the priority? That the ministry has been damaging his relationship with his wife, and yet he's expressing all this excitement and energy towards this new church opportunity, new ministry opportunity. And he's neglecting putting that same energy and investment into his relationship with his spouse. That broke my heart, and I will be having a response to him, but that was just today. Just today I got that. So that's a real trigger for me as well in terms of why this topic, the reason this topic is so critical.
Yeah. So someone reading those statistics in the situation even that you're talking about, Fred, or situations, Beth, that you've had, what do you think is the disconnect that occurs when someone reads that and then it makes, you know, little impact on them? Where do we fall off the table on this?
Beth, you want to respond to that first?
You go ahead, Fred.
Okay. You know, we boomers have this little phrase that I think came out of what was then Campus Crusade for Christ, is that 18-inch gap between the head and the heart. And, you know, we know in our head, this is what we should do. We teach it, we preach it, we counsel it, and it just does not, for many, not all, but for many individuals, it does not sink, the truth does not sink from the head into the heart to motivate us enough to do something about it. I mean, that's very simplistic. There's certainly many more facets to that, but I think that may be the bottom line issue right there. We do what I say, don't do what I do.
Yeah. Any thoughts, Beth, on that?
A disconnect. I think, yeah, what Fred said is true. And we often want to portray a certain, I mean, we think we have all these shoulds, biblical truths that, but life is hard, and living that out is much more difficult than it looks on paper. And so I think when we have to actually live it out, that's when it becomes challenging. And then we feel a lot of guilt and about not being able to live up to the standards that we put on ourselves. And I think it's a really difficult, there's not as much freedom to be able to walk in our humanity and be free to fail. And I think a lot of people, especially pastors and their families, feel like they're needing to be perfect. And so,
yeah. I think too, sometimes we can have a compartmentalized view of our spiritual life where we're expecting to see God move in our ministry or in our private, you know, individual devotional life, or not necessarily expecting God to come to us through the messiness of our personal relationships. And it, Fred, when you were talking about the email you received from this pastor friend, it reminded me of a phrase that Pete Scazzaro uses in his book, Emotionally Healthy Spirituality, where he talks about the fact that we can use God to run away from God, and how tempting it can be for people in ministry to run away from family problems and bury themselves in ministry work. Because we're not expecting God to come to us through the challenges of family life. And yet, isn't that so often where the real internal work needs to happen? So going back to this kind of initial question about the importance of healthy relationships and in relationship to our theology, what is the biblical basis for this? What's the biblical foundation that points us to seeing how important our relationships really are to God?
I assume that Adam had learned truth about God before Eve was created. And then God said, it is not good for man to be alone. So the theology came first, you know. The relationship with God came first, and then the relationship with Eve was secondary. So I think, you know, that's where we start, right there, in, as Beth alluded to earlier, right at creation. And then if we look through scripture, as I was thinking, deliberating on this week, it was like, okay, we got David and Jonathan, you know, who had a really solid love relationship in the correct way. And then Paul at the end of Romans, you know, he greets about 65 different people through his letters and thanking them for the relationship that he's built with them and what role they've been able to play in his own life. And we've got Ephesians 5:21, submit yourselves one to another out of reverence for Christ. In Titus, the characteristics of an elder, I just wrote down some: not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, not violent, not pursuing dishonest gain, being hospitable, loving what's good, self-controlled, upright, holy and disciplined. Those are all relational elements. And then it says at the very last sentence, he must firmly hold to the trustworthy message. So Paul was focusing on all these relational components, and then he wraps it up with, okay, you've got to be faithful to the gospel message. And Jesus saying, I call you friends, you know, after I've taught you everything, now I call you friends. Truth, relationship. And then at the very end of Revelation, when we're going to be worshiping God forever, you know, we're going to be with him, reigning forever and ever. Relationship, again, at the very end, all the way into eternity. So, you know, that's what I discovered in doing just my own little look-see into scriptures. I'm sure there's much more, but that was what I got.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and for me, I looked at John 13, 34. Love one another as I've loved you. And if Jesus is sent to us to love us, you know, then we are, that is a relationship and a person. You know, if he was sent in bodily form, you know, he cares so much that he sent his actual son. And he does love us, and he shows examples in his ministry on earth of loving people. And that is our example to love others.
Can I reference really quickly just another study that came out recently that I think really applies to this? It was a report from the Hartford Institute for Religion Research, and they, in 2023, they surveyed 1,700 pastors. And the report, the conclusion was, the report found half of clergy say they are at least often lonely, including 37% who are frequently lonely. Another 21% said they're sometimes lonely, and only a quarter say they are rarely lonely. And then it went on, it asked these six exclusive questions that were, and 11 questions modified from this Harvard Wellness Project. And the largest positive gap for pastors was on the level of, on the levels of support for the statement, I understand my purpose in life. Clergy scored 8.6, Americans in general scored 6.8. But this is what I found so critical. On the one issue pastors trailed Americans, my relationships are as satisfying as I would want them to be, pastors scored 6.7 compared to 6.8 for Americans. And then what was also interesting was the issue seems to be especially applicable among younger pastors. Those under 45 are the most likely to say they have a spiritual need to invest time and friendship and fellowship with others and relationships with others. And they are among the most likely to say they struggle with loneliness or lack of friendships as a mental challenge in ministry. Mm. I thought, wow. And that was just within a year that the study was done.
The recent Barna revisit on the health of pastors also indicates that there's still the gap there. in terms of lack of relational connection and sense of isolation and loneliness. So just a thought too, Fred, you brought this up, and I think Beth, you were landing on John 13. Is there something in the Trinitarian relationship biblically? I don't want to wax like super theological here or anything, but in the Trinitarian relationship, were you talking about how the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit love each other?
Mm-hmm.
And that maybe that forms even a more fundamental foundation for the need for relationships and the importance of them?
Yes, I think community. That was the first community. I mean, it's always been that way, that they've been in community with one another. And we know this because we, you know, of course, I study attachment theory, but we are attached first to God and then to others. But, you know, we crave community and desire to be attached and connected to other people. And that, I believe, is why, because of the Trinity, I mean, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit were together at first and are bringing us in to their community. So it's a joining, the way I see it. Like, we're able to and privileged to experience that. And so we crave that for our human life. I mean, we crave that in our families. You know, we're set up as a family unit to have that community and to belong, that sense of belonging. And I know that, you know, our sense of belonging is so strong, and it is theologically backed up, but it's so strong that we will sacrifice a lot of things just to belong to our families, like our identities, or, you know, just obviously you see that in teenagers when they want to belong to a group. It's a big drive. And I think it becomes, I mean, it's born in that Trinity community.
And when the Holy Spirit seals us in Christ, you know, we become that, as Beth said, we become that family, and we can call each other brothers and sisters, even though it's not human brother and sister. It's so far beyond that, and that is all the work of the Trinity, drawing us into that relationship. Mm-hmm. And as we, you know, as we look through Scripture, you know, we're convicted by the Holy Spirit when we're out of relationship with mm-hmm. with one another. And Jesus talks about forgiveness with one another.
Mm-hmm.
And God the Father is Abba. There's relationship there. It's it's so powerful, Roy.
Mm-hmm.
It is. I really appreciate just that reminder of how fundamental it is to our humanity being created in God's image, that we are made to need relationships, needing that attachment. I'd love to hear both of you talk about what can happen to us when that need to be attached is unmet. So we've already heard a little bit about how isolated some pastors feel. I know that sense of isolation also can be experienced in a really unique way by those who are married to pastors, maybe even more isolated in some ways because they don't have some of the vocational connections that the pastor has. But what can go wrong when we aren't having that need for healthy relationships met in the ways that the Lord wants to meet that need for us?
Beth, I'd invite you to go to do the marriage part of that. And then I'm going to give an example of something that didn't concern a marriage.
Okay. Yeah, for me, I mean, I'm a pastor's spouse, so I like you said, Annie, I did not work, and I think that might have helped, but I stayed home and with the children, and it was just, it was a tough, the signs of the isolation, you know, I had lots of friends before we entered ministry, and I just never even thought about friendships. My pastor and his wife growing up lived on campus, little did I know. I mean, they lived in a parsonage, and it just looked like a dreamy life to have all the people in and out of their home. And And then we entered ministry, and my expectations were that, gosh, this isn't quite what I thought it would be. And the strange comments, the expectations, you can't be too this, you can't be too that, you can't, you know, it felt like I couldn't connect with people. Also, my husband, you know, pastors are leaders, and leadership is isolating because you don't feel like you have that sense of colleague peers because you're in charge. And in many ways, your congregation sees you in this role. And so I just felt a sense of isolation. And I knew I was capable of making friends and having community, but I struggled to find, I felt misunderstood often. And I don't think people understand what that role is, what it's like. And I don't think they, nobody, I'm not blaming anybody in our congregations. It was just the way they see you creates a barrier at first, if you're not learning how to deal with it and finding those people in your life that you can connect with.
Yeah, so the first pastor situation that I counseled as a fairly new marriage and family therapist was with a pastor who came on staff at the church where I was. We had a Christian counseling center at the church, and it was a 4,000 member church, and we had 3 full-time therapists and 12 lay counselors. We were busy all the time. So this new pastor came on staff, and he had about 15 years of experience in ministry, and he had a PhD in systematic theology. He had a PhD in Greek, and he was a golden tongue. He could preach like no one's business. In fact, I was with a family last week. We had dinner with them, and they were members of that congregation at the same time I was there. And they still remember sermons that he preached 40 years later. That's how gifted a preacher, communicator, a preacher he was. But he never had a relationship with anyone on staff. And he was there about a year, maybe a year and a half, when he had an affair with another person on staff, divorced his wife. He was excommunicated through the disciplinary process. His response to the congregation when he left was, "If I've done anything to harm you, I'm sorry." He did not take any responsibility at all for his decisions, and lost contact with him for about 7 years or so, and then discovered that he became a realtor, and he got remarried and had a child, but also became extremely dependent on alcohol. And one day went back, he was then separated from his second wife because of other actions that he had been taking. One day he comes back to the home that he was not living in anymore with his wife and child, walked in, shot his wife, not fatally, and then in front of their young son committed suicide. Mm. Now that's an extreme situation. I understand that. But there he did not he removed himself from all relationship with everyone on staff. As far as we knew, and I did some counseling with him during the time he was on staff, he had no relationship with other people. That he, even with his wife, it was very thin, and his decisions were radical in every part of his life because there was no accountability. And even though he was brilliant, absolutely brilliant, and people looked up to him and oohed and awed, and he was almost like a god with a small g, to people, but he could not manage his own life. And I believe part of it, not all, but a part of that was lack of healthy relationships in his life that could speak into his life, care for him. He didn't receive any care, would chose not to receive any care from anyone, even though people reached out to him, and then ultimately ended up with a life that could have been so much a blessing to the kingdom of God because of his giftedness.
Far too many stories along those lines too. They are extreme, but they are less and less rare. So I'm going to switch gears on us just a little bit here.
Let's lighten it up a little bit.
No, that's all right. So I'm all ears on this one. Okay. Maybe the two of you can just envision me as, you know, on the couch in your therapy sessions. So in your experience, what are some key factors that give us a hint that a relationship is healthy, whether that's a marital relationship or a pastor and, you know, other relationships that they should have or could have? What are some hints that this is a healthy relationship?
Go for it, Beth.
Well, I'm sure we all can list off the top five things that we need in a relationship, like communication, trust, and these characteristics that you see. I think for me, in my role and in my marriage, certainly being understood and understanding the other person and the ability to be able to be ourselves and trust, obviously, and intimacy. I think boundaries are also a big, big deal to me in the ministry and also in my relationships. Because, I mean, ministry, you just have so many, that's a big word. And so I see in healthy relationships, you have to know who you are and where you stop and then where the other person starts, and being able to figure out physical boundaries, emotional boundaries, all kinds of relational boundaries. So that's one of the signs to me that you have a healthy relationship. Mm-hmm. But for me, being able to reciprocate, like in friendship, being able to be myself and take a turn. Like, for instance, one of the friends I had, we spent a lot of time together and I listened, and that's just something I do generally well. I love to listen and understand people, but I think when I started sharing a little bit about who I am and my needs, there wasn't necessarily a reciprocation. It was more of a one-way relationship. So I was more serving in purpose in her life, and it wasn't being reciprocated. So to me, that would be being understood, being heard, taking turns to share, and that commonality of trust too is a big deal. Obviously in ministry, confidentiality, that you're going directly, that the person comes directly to me when they're upset with me, and then I do the same for them, same in your marriage. Mm. So those are some of the things in ministry that have mattered to me.
Mm. Good.
Yeah, those are great, Beth. You stole all my thunder. not in any priority order here, but I think being a healthy relationship is where people can challenge one another in really beneficial ways to raise up the other person. I think encouragement is really important as well, that it goes back and forth. A willingness to be admonished. Mm. You know, a lot of times what we're looking for is people to build us up. But at times, you know, a healthy relationship says, I can speak into your life, maybe some hard things that you need to hear. And I think that's important. Looking forward to getting together with the other person, I think it is a sign of a healthy relationship. And then within the marriage context, I know, so before we came on to this, we were talking about marriage, and Roy is getting ready to celebrate 50 years of marriage. And in October, I'll be celebrating 47 years. And when I see my wife in a room, one of the first things I think is, there I am.
Mm.
It's like I say, thank God, you know, because in spite of me, he allowed her to come into my life. And so how a spouse thinks when they see their spouse, I believe is an indication of a healthy relationship. Sacrifice. What am I willing to give up so that my spouse is going to have, my wife's going to have her needs met, whether I get mine met or not? What am I willing to give up? Spending time together, and then also spending time apart, because the word that you use, Beth, trust. I know that the relationship is secure. I think that's part of a healthy relationship. We can enjoy the same activities, or I can really applaud her with the gifts that she has and say, you go for it, and exhibit what God has given you. I'm going to stand in the back, and I'm going to be your greatest cheerleading section. So yeah, so those are, and when I'm willing to give priority, if I'm watching a TV show that I like, maybe probably sports, okay, and my wife speaks to me over the years, it's become a habit now. It wasn't that way at the very beginning, but I mute the TV so I can give her my full attention without being distracted by the white noise in the background. And I think that's a sign of a healthy relationship, attentiveness. And as Beth said, listening, not just hearing, but listening.
Mm-hmm.
It's the other person saying.
That's great. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I do think this is an area, particularly in the area of friendship, where after a person has been in a ministry position for a while, it can be difficult for them or for their family to have those mutual relationships. And so I'm wondering, you know, if we've got people watching who are in that place and they're thinking about these characteristics of a healthy relationship and realizing, man, every single time I have lunch with someone or when I meet them for coffee, you know, everybody views me as a minister. They're not asking about how I'm doing, or maybe when they do, it's just kind of perfunctory and they don't really care. What's one step that someone in that kind of situation could take to try to find that healthy mutual friendship? What's one piece of advice you would give someone who realizes they've got a friend deficit?
Okay, I'll speak first this time. So I'm an introvert, and I'm content to do all my deciding in my head. And then when I speak, you hear what I've concluded, you know. And so it makes it really easy for me to sit and to listen and to ask the right questions and to engage in conversation. But as you said, Annie, so well, most often, I do not have questions asked of me. How are you doing? So my best friend, he and his wife, and my wife and myself, we've known each other since 1976. He's a retired pastor now also. And we get together once a month minimum. And He listens and he asks questions. And he's the person who has permission in my life to say the hard things to me. And we've developed that relationship over the years. They live 45 minutes away now, but we still carve out monthly time on our calendars where we get together and spend hours and catch up. And he's the person that I can really vomit to. So I would say the answer, not to say the answer, but an answer is make sure you have someone in your life who is on the outside of your main focus of your congregation, and give them permission to speak admonishment and encouragement into your life, and to say the hard things if you need to hear the hard things being said. And this is what my friend and his wife do for my wife and myself. And Beth and I, we got together and talked a few weeks ago in preparation for this. And one of the things I said to Beth, and this has just been my personal decision, is I never told my wife about any individuals in the congregation that I was counseling, or any of the problems I had with people in the congregation, because I wanted to protect her from seeing that person and going, oh, you know, that person's against my husband. So that's just my personal decision, and I know it's not the decision, but that enabled my wife to still have a relationship with people who she didn't know maybe had something against me or were opposed to me in some area. So she could still enjoy the relationships in the congregation, even though I may have been going through a time of persecution.
Oh, I appreciate what you said, Fred. I think that is helpful, that you wouldn't share. But I wonder what you'd say to the people who, but you also have voiced how important it is to have someone you can talk to. And it's not that you want to talk about those specific people, but what you're dealing with and how you're responding, because you certainly don't want to tell everybody, and you're not even telling your wife. So that increases your isolation even more.
Yeah. And I had a pastor's group that we met monthly for 17 years. And there were 7-8 of us that were consistently gathering together. And that's also where all of us in those meetings, we complained, we could be critical, we could encourage one another, but that was also a dumping area for each one of us, because we didn't know the people in each other's congregations. And so we could let it out and share our frustrations and our disappointments and righteous anger.
I agree. I think that is a really big key for me. I finally found one of my mentors is a pastor's wife, and she got 5 of us together. We drove hours to be together once or twice a year for a retreat. And then we did Zoom before it was a thing at COVID. just to connect. We didn't even have to say much. And it was not a like griping, like you said, we unloaded, but it was more about what we were processing and dealing with. And like the Psalms, you unload, you complain, and then you get through it, you move through it. So it's a process to be able to metabolize all that's going on, because it's a lot. And I think we just need to be able to, I'm an outward processor, so I need to journal or talk about it. And I don't have to say much to my pastor's wife's friends, because they get it. You know, I don't have to explain much. And that was nice, being understood. So I agree, like having people outside your church, and preferably in the ministry as well, who know what you're going through, and you don't have to say names. And it's really not, again, not about the people that you're talking about. It's just about you working through that and how to respond in the way that's best, I think, like the way we're called to love people. People are, we're all hard, we're difficult. And human nature is in everything we do, including mine, you know, so.
And I think agree. Personalities play a big role in this as well, because I just, for myself, I've never been one that holds grudges. And so my wife would tell you that she never saw me bring my work home with me. I think it's just an ability, a gift God has given me, that I was able to leave things at the office door and then come home and be engaged. And I can't say that that's the way everyone is, but that's just who I am, and it was really, really beneficial for me during my 40 years of ministry to not stress out when I was home.
Wonderful. Fred, do you think that in your experience working with people and pastors, that's a majority of people are able to do that, or do you see that that's more difficult?
It's more difficult. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Way very much more difficult. Mm-hmm. And I think if we're moving on this platform, this theme, you know, there's so many other things, like my running. Mm-hmm. It was so helpful to me. You know, when I was younger, I used to tell people, when I was younger, I was running 90 miles a week while still doing full-time ministry. And I would tell people, I run in the morning before work began, and I just say to people, you know, I would be so tired by the time I got done running, I didn't care what happened the rest of the day. You know? but I think that we need to find those outlets that can de-stress us as well. And for me, that was one of my de-stressors. But I know that for a number of pastors that, especially ones that I have counseled through moral failings, they did not have a place to express and de-energize that frustration and that anger and that hurt and that pain. They internalized it, and then the shotgun was triggered.
Mm-hmm. But I think that's really, really good and really important, you know, in this, that pastors having outlets, because I think in the running, or even in the pastors' groups, the pastors' wives' groups, there's an element of stepping into your humanness that then you don't, it's not work oriented, it's not any of that, it's just being a human being and being able to process the emotional things that are going on in your life. And I know when I pastored, and I'm ashamed to say that it's still not a full budded bloom in my life, is that I didn't have outlets or hobbies, things that I could turn to that would just allow me to be a human being. And that certainly contributed, you know, to a lot of the challenges that I faced.
Well, and it made me think also, you know, if you have those other outlets, other ways of working out anxiety in your body or stress or whatever it is, that's freight that you're not putting onto your relationships, right? Mm-hmm. You're allowing God to meet you in a variety of ways instead of just demanding, you know, that your marriage is the place for this, or that this one friendship just opens you up to be able to receive from the Lord and not necessarily require your relationships to do all that work for you. So I think it's important just to, yeah, as you're saying, embrace the full spectrum of what it means to be a human being. And our physicality, our need for movement is a big part of it that often gets neglected. In fact, we've done conducted a well-being survey among pastors in the EPC for 2 years now. And at least so far, what we've seen is consistently the aspect of a pastor's life where they get the least sense of well-being is the physical, is that physical aspect of their life. So Fred, I appreciate you sharing about the role that running played for you in your ministry, just giving you a place to unload that stress and maybe come into the office with a little less anxious energy than you might have.
And, or no energy.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah. So back to Beth, your comment on reciprocity in relationships. I think that anybody who's listening that's in ministry or any kind of leadership feels that lack of anybody asking you, you know, how you're doing. I'm curious. I was in a conversation today with a pastor, and I appreciated his approach. And it's something that I want to model because he said, so how are you coming to this conversation today? Mm-hmm. I thought that was a tremendous invitation to share how I was going to be present in that moment, you know. Have you seen other kinds of tools that maybe people can use that can make those kinds of invitations in relationships?
Do you mean if you're in that kind of relationship, inviting another person to care about you?
Yeah.
Instead of giving up and just saying they're not going to reciprocate.
Yeah,
I think people do want to know about our lives. But I think people actually really deeply care about us and want to know. And so offering, that's a great question, by the way, but offering information or even saying, you know, this is important to me. I'd like you to hear about, you know, like, for instance, I'll give you an example. We care for so many people and their relatives and their family. And when I find myself getting a little resentful, like when something may happen to my mother or my family, I generally just don't even mention it. Mm. It's just a habit. I don't even say anything to anyone because I'm not prioritizing. Like, they don't even know sometimes when my mom has been hospitalized or when something's going on in our family. But I think they care so much and so deeply that just going ahead and sharing, even if it's clunky, you know, not a beautiful question, mm-hmm. but just sharing this is what I want you to know about me, you know, and it's not too vulnerable and testing out to see if they're, you know, trustworthy or if, you know, just taking baby steps to see if they can handle and are curious about you and what's going on with you. I wouldn't tell them about my marriage or the arguments we have, but I certainly share lots and lots of other things. And I definitely think they care about my family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, my favorite question for when I meet with other pastors, and it's not for a counseling session, it's just generally sitting down and catching up. How is it with your soul? And then I have to confess that when people ask me that, because it does not happen often, it's really awkward for me to respond. Really awkward. I'll give a short, it's going okay. You know, it's fine. Now with my best friend, he gets more than that, but in other conversations, relationships, it's so unusual for me to be asked. I feel awkward is the best way to mm-hmm. describe it. I just don't know how to then get into dialogue, engage mm-hmm. with that. Mm-hmm. And it's not that I'm not self-aware, it's I don't know how to communicate that well. and so that only reinforces, well, I don't have to ask Fred again what's going on, because I'm not going to get much from him. So that's Beth, a good point. I can use some counseling from you.
What?
I can use some counseling from you, Beth.
That's a good point, Fred, that we're just not used to it. And so when we're asked, we just kind of, we're used to being dismissed. So we just give them the short answer and move on. Yeah. Do you really care?
Yeah.
I can relate, Fred, except you said it's not that I'm self-aware. I'm just not used to being asked. Sometimes I'm genuinely not self-aware. Like, I'm so task-oriented. If I'm in a meeting or something, I'm just focused on the agenda. And so if someone stops and says, you know, really, how are you? I have to take a moment and check in with myself and like, oh, that's a good question. How am I? Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's a gift. It's a gift when someone really does want to know and they are listening for a real answer. That's such a gift. And it's not something we get all the time when we're in ministry leadership. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious with the two of you, Fred, you've had the experience of serving as a pastor for decades. Beth, you've been a pastor's wife for, you said, 28 years now. Was there an experience that you had, or was it just a season of life you went into where you realized that you needed to prioritize relational health? What was it that brought you onto this journey with the Lord? Because I think we all know, we've acknowledged, not everybody gets there. You know, even people who've dedicated their lives to flourishing ministries, serving Jesus with seemingly everything they have, and yet this relational component of being a human being just never rises to that level of priority. So what was it for each of you that led you down this road of prioritizing relationships?
So in my fourth year of marriage, third year of marriage, my wife came home from work and she had a frustrating day. And so I went into counseling mode, and her response was, "Fred, I don't need a counselor. I need a husband." And her words were so spot on. And it was at that point I recognized I was acting out a role with her and not being a person with her. Mm. And so that truth floated over into other relationships. You know, as I began to evaluate, okay, what was going on in the other relationships I had in my life? And yes, what I had become was not a friend, but a counselor. And so I've had to work at this I'm still working at it for 40 years, still trying to become that friend, that being, rather than that performer.
Hmm.
That's good.
Very good. That's good. I appreciate that. And we maybe have a few conversations that were similar to that in my home. For me, it was a period of, it was after we have four children and they were young, and I was just feeling very isolated and alone, as if no one understood what was going on. I didn't feel like I could reach out to anybody. And it was such a loneliness that it was painful. And I didn't know where to go. I didn't know if I could trust anyone. And that's when I reached out to a pastor's wife, like my mentor. She was in North Carolina, and she kind of hooked up this group. But I also found Jerry Scazzaro. You mentioned the Scazzaros, Annie. But it was a book at the time she had out that said, "I Quit." But now it's called The Emotionally Healthy Woman. But basically she quit, you know, I know there's, you know, their story where she just said, "I can't do this anymore. I can't do the performance based. I can't do this pretending." So that was a point for me where I realized I had to be who I am and be comfortable with that. And I had to let go of a lot of what other people were thinking about me and our family, and let our kids be kids, and not have these unusual expectations put on them as well. We were just going to be a typical family and nothing more. So that really took the weight off for me. So that was one of the breaking points that actually turned out to be very, very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Can I follow up on a topic that Beth spoke to earlier? I think it fits into this, and that's the whole area of boundaries. Because when I first set up boundaries, I thought, oh, this is going to be really helpful for me, but they were punitive boundaries. Mm. You know, it wasn't they weren't healthy boundaries. It was to punish people who tried to get too close, mm, or tried to disrupt what my head thought I needed to be doing. And so I had to learn over the decades that boundaries are really to protect ourselves, not to punish other people. And I think that is one of the experiences that that helped me to allow relationships to develop, is recognizing that, okay, not every boundary is the same. And I need to define them more clearly regarding who it was that I was establishing the boundary with, and that my heart was in the wrong place because I was slapping them on the hand, or I was intentionally pushing them away. It was punishment, not protection for my own soul.
Mm. That's good. That's a great insight.
Mm-hmm.
This has been really great, guys. So just as a recap, I'm going to ask a question. But before I do, I want to make sure that those who are watching online tonight can ask their questions from here on. So we'll watch the Q&A section of the Zoom meeting, and you can send your questions in, and Annie and I will field those and pass them on. So just as a recap, what are some steps? What may be the first step, but what are some steps that pastors or pastors' spouses or married couples can take to really move out of isolation, move into, you know, healthy relationships? What are some key factors? We've talked about a few. Maybe you can recap those. Maybe you can add to them.
Well, I would go back to the question I referenced earlier, was how is it with your soul? Now, what's your relationship with God, right? You know, that sounds almost simplistic, but I think that's, I believe that might be pretty easy for a pastor to skim over, to be maybe a little superficial with, and not to peel back the layers and look at what's going on in the heart, rather than just, oh, I know Jesus is my Savior. I do my devotion every single day. I'm preaching, so I'm getting the word out there. I'm with people all the time, so I have a relationship. And I think that's a lie we tell ourselves, is that just because people are around us, we think that's relationship. And I think we do that with God too, okay? Because I know God's there. We have a relationship, but there's an intentionality that needs to occur that goes deep. And again, I'm speaking as an imperfect person in this arena, because I'm still learning what it means to have God build his relationship with me in me.
Good. Beth, you got any?
That's great, Fred. Yeah, I would agree with that for sure. And I would say just find someone you can trust and cry for help. I mean, it can be a family member, or like my sister is my, I mean, just voice it. whether, you know, of course, ask about or question your relationship with the Lord as a priority, but I would reach out and ask. But don't stay there is my word for you. Just keep thinking about and be creative about who you can trust and just ask for help.
Mm-hmm. And I came up with this little slogan. I don't know how it's going to go over. It's going to sound really pastoral, but I would say to myself and my pastor friends, slow down and savor the Savior. Mm. Like that articulation there. Mm-hmm.
Slow down.
Nice alliteration.
Yes. That'll alliteration. Preach.
Yes. Slow down and savor the Savior. Again, so many pastors are so involved in so many areas. We know that as, you know, that as pastor's wife, you know, that as pastors, you know, we get running and we don't know when to call time out often, not all the time, but often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And sometimes we're running hard like that again, because we're running from some things that are difficult to face. And so we need that assurance of God's presence with us, especially in the face of other people, right? Brothers and sisters who can be trusted, who can help us unpack the hard things of life and be the physical presence of Christ with us by the power of the Spirit. So, so important, but it takes time, doesn't it? There's no substitute.
Yeah.
For the time that it takes.
And if I could add to this just a little bit, let me speak to the marriage thing here for just a moment, because you know, every year we have a State of the Union message. I think every marriage needs to have a State of the Relationship message. You know, where you sit down, you know, whether it's a date night or whatever, get out of the house, get away into a neutral place, and just talk about the state of the relationship. And the other thing, and I was a violator of this, be intentional about vacations. And really push hard on your session to give you a sabbatical and use it. Mm-hmm. And use it. Don't just have it in your job description. Take advantage of it. Mm-hmm. And then the last thing I would say, because I think this is critical also, is examine, is there any unforgiveness in your heart regarding anything that's going on in your ministry? Because that is going to erode your soul over time.
That's good. I will just say one more thing, if you wouldn't mind. It's not necessarily related to what you were just saying, but something that came to mind was, as a spouse of a pastor, he is, you know, of course you get criticisms, but everybody thinks he's, you know, got it all together. And so there were periods of time when I resented his attention and time to the congregation. And so it is very important to spend time with your spouse and to prioritize that relationship. Because if you don't have that, you don't have your ministry. So
that's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Absolutely. Well, the Q&A is open for questions. Those of you who are watching and listening in, please don't hesitate. Beth and Fred they're here for you.
That's right. I was wondering if the two of you could comment on, you know, we have a unique blessing being Presbyterians because of our connectional nature. Maybe one or both of you could speak to how we can leverage this connectionalism of being Presbyterian versus congregational in developing healthy relationships as ministry leaders or people married to ministry leaders. Mm-hmm.
Annie, that's why you were hired.
No, it's Annie. Yeah. You're here.
We trust in Annie.
No, even before I was, there were Presbyterians. And ministerial committees and chaplains and yes, all these relationships that we can just, if we just reach out and take that risk, right? They're there to support us. And I'd be interested in hearing some thoughts just from your experiences. How have you seen our form of government even be a benefit to people who might be struggling in ministry?
Well, I'm going to brag about the Presbytery of the West. And we, for years, decades, we've had a yearly pastor's retreat, and that's has cultivated fellowship and relationship. We have a chaplain who serves our presbytery. So if anyone has any needs, whether emotional, spiritual, mental health needs, we have a chaplain available who's paid by our presbytery, and he's also an EPC pastor. He's just wonderful. He also oversees cohorts. At our presbytery meetings, we always have a time of fellowship. So it's not just business, but we bring in a speaker who will distract us from business as such and speak to matters of the heart, which I think are really important. And then the younger guys go out typically after presbytery meetings, and they'll have a beer together and enjoy each other. I just can't stay up past 9 anymore. So, but I think I can only speak for our presbytery, but kudos to our leadership here who continue to foster that, not only at the presbytery level, but I know, Annie, just because you're on staff now, the EPC is having that mindset as well. And I think you're developing and cultivating a great garden here for us to grow and prosper in.
I will say that too. And I love that the denomination values relationships and healthy families, healthy pastors, healthy families. That's a priority. And connectionally for me, I love that, like you said, Fred, my husband has the presbytery to be able to connect with, and also like a pastor's retreat. But for me, the pastor's wife's luncheon at GA, I mean, the fact that they even invite women, I mean, the pastor's spouses to come to presbytery and families, that shows that they value it. Mm-hmm. So that's been beneficial to me to feel connected in that way.
Oh, that's so good. It's good to hear that. Well, and that you led me into a plug that I wanted to make at some point, Beth, which is this year at General Assembly, of course, most people have heard we're really making a big push to have families come, especially for those who have children still at home. They've got great activities planned. But something that we haven't promoted yet is that, you know, every year at General Assembly, we have free coaching support available to our pastors. This year, we're also going to be offering that free coaching support for pastors' spouses as well. So if you or your spouse are going to be coming to General Assembly, at some point after you register, we will send you an email so that you have an opportunity to sign up for one of those free coaching sessions, because we do want to continue to grow in the ways that we offer support to one another and just encourage each other to continue to grow in every aspect of life as we follow Christ, not only in our biblical and theological development, certainly, but also in our relational health, in our mental and emotional well-being, and our physical health. And so expanding that free coaching support to spouses this year is one way that we're seeking to do that better.
Wonderful.
Great.
Yeah.
Good. Well, at this point, we have no questions. You have answered
so thorough.
You were. This has just been a wonderful conversation. And thank you both for giving some time to us tonight and for helping us think through how our relationships play into not only healthy ministry, but again, just being whole followers of Christ and growing as his disciples. Thank you.
Thank you guys very much. Yeah, appreciate it.
All right, friends. Well, stay tuned. In the months ahead, we're going to continue with this Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families series. We'll have more guests coming along and be sharing some more resources with you as you seek to continue to grow and foster a healthy family. So, Roy, can I ask you to pray us out tonight? Offer a sure. blessing?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Lord, thank you for the insights and experience and wisdom that you've given Beth and Fred, their willingness to share that with us, knowing that we are all still on the journey. I pray that those who have listened tonight and who will listen in the future will benefit so much from what has been shared and will take those intentional steps to reach out and build relationships, and within those relationships they have, that they will seek to do those well under the guidance of your Holy Spirit. Thank you that we are rooted in good theology. It does not oppose healthy relationships, because you are the God who invites us in, creates hospitality for us, and then calls us to love and do the same for those around us. So give us the courage to do that, Father. And we bless you for each that's watched tonight, for Beth and Fred, for Annie. Thank you for your goodness and mercy to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
You.
So good to be with you all. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bless. Bye-bye. Bye, Beth.
Bye.